Yeah, Tim, what are you drinking right now?
I'm drinking a Bud Light 2 years ago, I think.
Yes, you are. Oh, the pool party. It tastes pretty good, dude. Well, cheers.
I think that's a blast.
It's awesome to be here.
I like to surround myself with folks that are just getting out there, doing it, believing in it. We can say faking it. That gets me going, that gets me energized, that gets me excited and passionate. And I think that's what is this about, you know, not to get all aspirational, but you know, doing it, you know, executing, that's the key.
All right, everybody. Thanks for tuning in. I'm here in beautiful, outside of LA, California. Up perched atop a precarious hill with Timothy Lee. I'm super excited to sit down with him. He's a pretty prolific guy in a lot of different places, a lot of different fields. We've kind of been talking about his various entrepreneurial ventures that he's launching into the future, and we'll go into a little bit of what he's done in the past, but really cool guy, and we kind of met in a super interesting way, which I think you guys would be interested to hear about. So. We're here sharing a couple Bud Lights, which is awesome. But without further ado, here is Tim Lee. Tim, thanks for coming on.
Absolutely. Thanks,
Derek, for coming in to my house. met you 2 years ago, maybe even 3 years ago, in a very interesting way. I flew into Denver for business and sure enough, whipped out my phone, Uber, called for a ride, and I think we mixed up the upper deck and lower deck. It was all sorts of mix-ups, right? So I finally found this late vintage Toyota 4Runner, and in the driver's seat was Derek Ball. So
yes,
sat in the passenger seat, had a great conversation with a gentleman here, young guy, very passionate about life in general, got a big family, so it was travel around the country quite a bit. So at the time, I thought he was a very interesting guy to talk to. So anyways, it was a 45-minute ride. Great conversation, dropped me off. On the way back, I said, Derek, why don't you pick me up and, you know, we'll continue the conversation. So, you know, 5 o'clock, showed up on the dot, took me home, took me back to the airport. And that was just an Uber ride, so to speak, right? For numbers of months, and I found myself back in Denver, you know, doing business, same firm that I was consulting with, and I said, well, I pre-arranged a ride. I got your business card, I think it was, right, Realty, and say, hey, why don't you pick me up at Denver Airport? I'm going to be there on so-and-so date, no problem, showed up on time, and we just had a great conversation again, caught up on everything. On the way back to LA from Denver, I wrote him a message saying that, hey, look, you know, of all the things we talked about, podcast, life, university, experience, and just Gen Z, Y, X, whatever you want to call it, people that were born after 1990s and 2000s, wanted to do something for me and my firm, which is realtymogul.com, crowdfunding real estate investing platform out here in LA, and wanted to help me on the marketing side of the house, identify all these podcasts, Tim Ferriss and all of that and see if we can, you know, get him to advertise for us, right? So cut scene 3 months later, he's sitting in my living room, well, kitchen, so to speak, talking about life again, and he's working on his true passion project, which is a podcast on wheels. Saw it, loved it, has already done some amazing interviews, so I'm just happy to be part of it and see this young man, Derek, kind of grow in his career and life. Willing to help out any way I can. So welcome to Southern California.
Hey, thanks for having me. We're sipping on Bud Light right now. Cheers.
Cheers.
No, but it's been a super cool ride. And I think for people listening, this has been a super important thing for me to learn in my kind of trajectory in life. But the idea that, so Tim is a pretty, if you look at him on paper, look at his resume, pretty intimidating guy. Has done a lot, has been very successful. And I think a lot of people, including me, when I see like a Harvard Business School graduation certificate or something like that, it's easy to be very intimidated by that. And for good reason, there's a lot that goes into doing that. But it's also incredible to realize that people are people, and I can, by just having this weird random conversation with this guy who jumped in my Uber, can turn it into something like this 3 months later or whatever, a year later. And I could be sitting drinking Bud Light in
your
kitchen.
Yeah.
And I think there's something so cool about that. And I think that's something that probably didn't exist maybe 15 years ago, like the opportunity for something like that to happen.
Right. You would think that Uber is already disruptive as is, but it brings people together and certainly brought Derek and I together in a very interesting way. But there's nothing, you know, for the past 30, I just turned 37 last couple of weeks ago. There's nothing mystical, egotistical about anybody's life, right? Having these conversations like this is very satisfying to me and hopefully to everybody else listening today. Talking about Harvard Business School, you know, you show up and essentially they drop Harvard Business Review magazine on your lap and say, well, we're going to flip to, you know, page 46. I'm like, well, I already subscribed to this kind of stuff. And why am I reading this stuff again? But, you know, it's actually the guy that wrote it is teaching the course, right? That's what's interesting.
Yeah.
But what's really interesting, back to what Derek was talking about, is the human side of it, right? I've got, you know, the CEO of Walmart Canada sitting next to me, and I've got VP of Southeast Asia Operations of Halliburton sitting there learning some stuff. And the thing that really gravitated or still really sort of imprinted on me was humanity, human condition. We have small study groups every night to go through the you know, the day's work, and there's a gentleman in our group. I think he's Middle Eastern, right? He's very sharp in class, very sharp. So all of us was looking forward to sort of having him participate in the nightly discussions. I want to hear his story, his experience, just like this conversation. He would never show up. And we see him in the hallway walking back and forth. I'm like, hey, you know, come on. I'm not going to name names here, but, you know, we're all of us are chipping in, right?
Yeah.
Why don't you sit down and talk about this, you know, how Disney acquired, you know, Pixar. You know, this is a great story. I want to hear your perspective. Never shows up. So one day we cornered him in his dorm room. I said, look, you know,
you got a bat in your hands, right?
Right. It's like, you got to participate, right? Part of this whole experience is participation. We want to hear your story. You're live in class. And, you know, like, I know it's after hours, but that's part of it, because everybody else is super engaged. And he said to me, or another guy that was kind of, you know, I didn't want to go myself because he was a big guy, right? He said, Tim, you know, I love to participate, but I can't be there. I'm like, well, I mean, why? You know, we're here, we're paying top dollars and whatever to be here to have this experience. He's like, well, I can't be there because there's a female in the study group.
Oh.
So, you know, we're not dumb. So I look at my buddy over there and say, well, totally understood, totally got it, right?
Yeah.
Because of cultural differences, customs, religion, all of that kind of just kind of suck into my head. It's like,
totally.
Wow, I'm a D-bag for even coming to him and trying to make him feel bad about himself, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he said it in such a genuine way. And I thought, this is what this whole experience is about.
Yeah.
For that 1 second that I kind of just, none of the other stuff really mattered. It was this is what really mattered. It's understand people at this level.
Totally.
That was probably the most memorable experience that I have at this school. The school is great. The experience is great. But going back to what Derek was talking about, right? Being able to connect with another person at a different level goes beyond this 4.7-inch screen that I'm holding in my hand. Goes beyond, you know, anything that we've ever experienced. And I hope everybody takes the opportunity. It's going to talk to their friends and family, strangers, right? Strike up a conversation. You will learn so much from just having a calm, collected conversation.
Yeah. No, and I think from my end too, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's easy to get caught up in this when you're at more of the bottom of the totem pole. It's easy to get caught up in this mindset of, you know, this guy, Tim, he went to Harvard Business School. He brushed shoulders with all these crazy people. Like, he probably has a lot of people that are kind of like going to him and trying to do this kind of like pull on your coattails or whatever you want to call it, you know? And so I think it's easy to get kind of lulled into inaction because of that,
mm-hmm.
Instead of just realizing, hey,
like, maybe, I would assume on your end, it was probably pretty flattering to be asked to be on a podcast. Maybe, I don't know. But I think just realizing again, like that human side of things, like just because you may have attained this level of success or something that I hope for someday, doesn't mean that you're not still like flattered when someone says, like, gives you a compliment or something like that, you know, like, and that's, I think, goes along with what you're saying. Just,
yeah, don't get me wrong. I'm super excited to be part of this.
I'm much more excited that you're a part of it.
Podcast aside, I think it was, you know, just having, Derek or hopefully vice versa to be part of this whole experience as we kind of traverse through this life. That's what makes it interesting. Ego, career, success aside, meeting people, having conversations, just talk about the things,
yeah,
experiences. I think that goes a long way. No, I'm just happy to be part of it, and I want Podcast on Wheels to be very successful going forward. I'll help out, you know, wherever I can.
Hey, you and me both, my friend.
That's right.
So Tim, next question. I think it'd be really cool. I think being, it's weird even calling myself an entrepreneur. Hearing you call me an entrepreneur is very strange. And I think that is how a lot of people feel, to mm-hmm. be honest. So we were kind of talking earlier about this idea of fear and entrepreneurship. And I know for a fact in my own life, so I started a company called The Time for Change Watches in college. And there was so much weird doubt, self-doubt, fear that I was just racked with before doing that. And I think that's a point that most people feel but don't get ever mm-hmm. past. Mm-hmm. And just kind of that initial fear and that initial, you got to get to the cliff and then you got to jump off, you know? And so maybe if you could talk about that, you're someone who's mm-hmm. been in a lot of startup companies and a lot mm-hmm. of different cool entrepreneurial places in general. So how do you cope with that fear? How do you feel about that fear?
Right. So early on, you know, in my career, maybe even going back to my college days, it was pure fear because mm-hmm. there was nothing, there was nobody there, to kind of show you what ought to be done, you know. Even your parents, right? They want you to have your own experience, explore the world, and all that stuff. So early on in my life, certainly, I think with a lot of folks out there, it was just pure fear. Why am I doing this? How can I get accomplished? Why am I even thinking about these things? And a lot of self doubt. But over the years. Things that you could do to overcome that fear is preparation. And I think a lot of things that, Derek, you've done is prepare yourself, not necessarily to overcome the fear, but prepare for the day that you will face that fear, mm-hmm. right? The fear of being alone, the fear of being out there doing something that nobody believes in, the fear of, you know, practically speaking, raise the money to fund your podcast, to raise the money to fund your startup. Those are all fears that are... that are common to a lot of entrepreneurs. But preparation is everything. But to be prepared for something doesn't mean that you're going to be successful. Somebody else will have to give you an opportunity if you don't create one for yourself. Mm-hmm. So the old adage of, you know, preparation is one thing, but, you know, when the opportunity knocks or comes to you, are you ready to take it on?
Absolutely.
Certainly, there's no silver bullet. I've never sort of said, hey, you know, I've got it, bring it, I can fix it. Every day is a struggle, even for me today, right? I got to talk through investors, mentors, advisors, co-founders of sorts to answer questions. And it's okay to show your fear. It's okay to kind of tell people, I don't know, I want your advice. It's okay mm-hmm. to say, I have done it. Wasn't successful. Please tell me what I ought to be doing. So what I'm trying to say is that to overcome that fear, practice, prepare, but don't be shy about asking for help. Don't be shy about asking for advice, because I think that's the only way to get through.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think related to that, one thing, whenever people come to me and ask, like, whoa, dude, like, you're so lucky, you're doing, like, this stuff. And first of all, it's not luck. Like, there's so much work that went into all
of
this.
I'm shaking my head. I agree with you.
Yeah, he's wagging the finger. But yeah, yeah. Totally, like, it's so weird how, because once you're being seen by people, that's, like, that's the end, you know? Like, mm-hmm. that is the end of, like, a long, hard, arduous journey. that people don't see, and people like may think that they know what goes on, but like
it all looks easy, right?
Totally. And then the other thing I was thinking, the biggest lesson I've probably learned on any of this is that everyone in this world is faking it till they make it.
That's right.
And like it's such a big realization, because like anyone you talk to, like they, first of all, whenever you start something, like what, you start college, you're not a college graduate, and
that's
then
right.
you go, you fake your way through college basically until you get to senior year and you're feeling great. You know how to do, you know how to fake the game at that point.
Right.
And then you're done, you know, but like anything you ever do is you have to decide you want to be it, and then you have to put in actionable steps to do it.
That's right.
But like that first step is faking it. Like you have to, I don't know if I'm a podcaster until I start acting like I'm sitting here.
You're doing it now, bro.
Exactly.
To fake it, you got to believe it.
Yeah.
Right. So that goes hand in hand. For Derek to take a leap of faith to start doing this, take a lot of guts, but takes a lot of preparation as well, right? And it takes a lot of good people around him to kind of not show him what's possible, but you know, he did a great job surrounding himself with other folks that are doing it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Believing in it or faking it, if you will, and that certainly helped me. And that's why I like Derek so much, because Derek helps me to kind of not to idolize you in any way. Don't get crazy now. To say, well, Derek is doing it every day, right? I am gonna follow suit and do it every day, because otherwise I'll become a disappointment to Derek. So I like to surround myself with folks that are just getting out there, doing it, believing in it, we can say faking it. That gets me going, that gets me energized, that gets me excited and passionate. And I think that's what is this about, you know, not to get all aspirational, but you know, doing it, you know, executing.
Absolutely.
That's the key.
Well, no, and it's so funny you say that too, because, well, first of all, it's super flattering hearing you say that, but, no, in general, it's so funny how everything is just about the different perspectives. Because on my end, like, you were totally that, like, pie in the sky kind of, like, what I want to be in 10, 15 years, you know? Just in general, like, I met you and, like, you were very just on top of your game and, like, just, you know? Like, and so it's funny how my weird, young, passionate self might have done kind of the same goading that your older, more experienced self did. And, like, I never would have ever known that, though, you know? Like, I never would have known that some random Uber ride would do anything to affect like anyone who has had the kind of modicum of just success that you've had, you know? So I think that's, again, what I love about this is just, hopefully people start to realize this too, is like, we probably harp on this too much, but people are people. And it's
just, that's right.
And you don't know what anyone else is going through. You don't know what anyone else is like, how they're viewing the world.
That's right.
And the only way you can possibly know that is by sitting down and talking to them and maybe getting over your own fears and getting
that's
to that
right.
point.
That's right. Before we turn on the mic, we were joking about, you know, in college, grade school, et cetera, we become test takers and we learn how to take the wrong pill, right?
Mm-hmm.
Making a reference to a really bad movie.
Matrix.
The Matrix. but Neil, if you will, right, followed by Rabbit, right, there was that leap of faith. There was that, venture into the unknown. But once you cross the chasm, it just is, right? Nothing stopped. Everybody else is going about their own business. But since you've, generically speaking, broke through, give yourself a pat on the back,
mm-hmm.
right? Generically speaking, because you've done something that nobody else has done before. And it is yours to own, right? All of us, if we're lucky, get another 40, 50, 60 years on this planet. Just do it. Execute. Try it. Right? Not hurting other people, of course, but just do it. Try it and see how it feels. You know, one of the mentors that I've worked with said, Tim, jump in a pool and tell me how cold it is.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Don't ask.
Yeah. Just the fact that you did it, it's half the battle. Do it, try it, find good people, surround yourself with Derek's of the world, yourself out there. Is it different to breakthrough? Of course it is. Is it the end of the world? Absolutely the opposite. I don't know. My message is do it. The old adage goes, you know, if you don't make a choice, if you don't act, right, you will regret it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, maybe 20 years down the line. But the fact that you've done it, it's a different satisfaction. But that's just the beginning. You got to carry through.
Yeah, my dad always used to say, this is a classic Frank Ballism. He said, do it now, don't wait, hesitate, and you're lost. And so sometimes in moments I'll think to that, the old man giving me adages. But I think it's so true. And it's like, also going back to the fake it till you make it thing, there's a point that happens that the self-doubt goes away. You wake up one day and instead of it being like, I'm climbing my way towards being a podcaster or whatever it is, you suddenly feel like you're a podcaster. And that moment is like this really weird thing, but you just like made the loophole in your brain. Like, all, what is a goal but to like shoot something off in the distance and like decide that that's what you're going to try to do.
That's right. Ballism. I think I've heard it for the first time. That's awesome. And I think the great Dan Gilbert, the CEO and founder of Quicken Loans, I'm paraphrasing here, said leadership, innovation maybe, is admired.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We all love that kind of stuff, right? But execution is worshipped. Do it.
Yeah.
Take action. Right? Do what Derek is doing. Do what a lot of the successful entrepreneurs out there is doing. Take the leap of faith. Technology, society is moving faster and faster and faster. You know, I can't wait. I can't wait to see the next Airbnb, Uber.
Oh, I know. We're poised for one, right?
We had to, right? Well, yeah. Between Derek and I, we kind of talked about what I'm going to do, and hopefully you'll be part of it soon. Hopefully, I'm very hopeful, but I'm looking forward to the next Intel, AMD, NVIDIA, Microsoft.
Yeah.
The world is yours. There's so much technology, so much momentum going on for humanity itself. I'm super excited to see what's going to come.
So Tim, one last question. So we've talked a lot about kind of college and kind of all of this, getting over your fears, mm-hmm. entrepreneurially and otherwise. And it seems to me, and I always felt this, I always did everything that was expected of me, like all throughout high school and college, was in all the right clubs, was getting all the right grades, and then got to the end of college and felt like I was being pushed along this very specific highway path towards like a big five accounting firm or something like that, like a big corporation, which is not bad. Like there needs to be big corporations. Mm-hmm. But for me, who was someone I knew I wanted to go on like more of the road less traveled, I felt a very big lack of options, or at least lack of just kind of roadmaps to get me there. So you, as someone who just got off lecturing at Wharton and have done a lot of cool things, like what advice would you give to a kid, 22-year-old that's just getting out of college, who is kind of navigating that weird world where there's advice leading you in the direction? It's interesting to me that you seem to be led in the direction of, you go on all these case studies, you read everything, and it's like the people that do the opposite of what the case study says, those are the people that are super successful, but we are leading people in our college institutions down this other path that's not really that. So
yeah, I like to say that, well, thanks for asking that question. I recently taught a course to some of the executives around the world at Wharton. So first time at Wharton, great school, rivals to Harvard, of course, but so the course is in real estate, the course is in fintech, and sure enough, the guy that was teaching the course to is the CEO of Baidu, which is the second largest search engine of China. What can I say to this person, right, that's meaningful in his life? But he was there listening attentively, and I was blabbering, like you said, Derek was faking it, right? As usual. But the fact that he was there, the fact that all the other students was there, learning, experiencing, you know, again, that's what it was about. And a couple of months before that, I was teaching a fintech course at USC, and the amount of enthusiasm at USC, the kids over there, well, they're not really kids, but they're, you know, young people there, was invigorating, was very interesting to me, lots of interesting questions. I think, you know, I could totally tell one of these guys or most of these guys are going to go out and do the next Lending Club, Prosper, Avant Credit, and PayPal, you know, Ripple, Bitcoin, you name it, right? So it was very satisfying to see there's, it's all there, it's all happening, right? These people, just the fact that they were there, took an elective course, listened to some old fart like me to talk about stuff that I've done 10 years ago was very satisfying, because they're the one that's going to do it. Derek, is going to be the one that's doing it. But, you know, look, I don't have any sage advice. I went through the same rigmarole, got out of college, worked at Intel, right, out of all places, and J.P. Morgan Chase, and, you know, the evil empire for 5-6 years. But within these, within the belly of the beast, you know, you can still innovate, right? You can still work on really cool stuff. You can still, there are still really interesting, smart people in these conglomerates, and I mean, naturally you will gravitate to these to these folks, and these are lifelong relationships, like we said, that we've developed throughout the years. You know, a project I'm working on right now, which I can't really talk about, we'll wait till the next episode.
The super secret
squirrel project is a guy that I've worked with 10 years ago, mm-hmm. right, and we always kind of kept in touch, worked at different places, sometimes together in different places, and you know, it's one of the things is lifelong relationship. But I don't have any, you know, I'm not gonna pretend that I have any sage advice, but stay on top of your game, even if you're working at, you know, the big five. Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah,
there's always individuals out there within it, without it, outside of it, that you find engaging. Get a hold of those guys. Start a relationship. Get a conversation going. Talk about ideas. It's really easy to get you self-looped into an 8-to-5 job and watch Netflix for 3 hours afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, learn from Derek. Learn from some of the guys out there that's doing it. Take the right pill. I don't know what to say, right? Going back to the same bad reference to a really bad movie. But, you know, read. I don't know.
Read
some interesting stuff.
Yeah, I think in general, like, maybe what you think is lack of advice is probably some of the best advice out there, which is that we're all bumbling around, we're all trying to figure mm-hmm. it out, and just do it a little more confidently and do it in the direction of your dreams.
Yeah, exactly. What I would say. Treat folks with respect, and you will never know the amount of output information you get out of folks, right? People, we're social animals, and the least we can do out there, whether you're in college, out of college, or 10, 20 years into your career, have a conversation. Find somebody that you like, share some experiences, talk about concepts and ideas. You know, you never know what's going to happen.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, Tim, it's been awesome. Thank you so much for having me in your humble abode on this beautiful hill in beautiful California.
Yeah.
It's been awesome getting to know you. It's been awesome kind of as our relationship has progressed, and I only
Absolutely.
Hope that it becomes even cooler in the future, and I have
Absolutely.
Faith that it will.
Hopefully it was good for us and the audience, and happy to be back on again to talk about the future.
Absolutely.
All right, cool.
Thanks, Tim.